Beyond and hello everyone, my name is Jonathon Dornbush and this is Podcast Beyond, IGN's weekly PlayStation show covering all the latest and greatest in the world of PlayStation, including some of the biggest games of the month that we're going to get into because there are so many releases this March to talk about, as well as some brief news that we're going to, you know, just recap before we get into all of that. But before we do, I'm joined this week by Mark Medina.
Severance is the best show on TV right now.
It's so good, Mark.
It is the best.
It's so good. Yeah, we could just turn this into a Severance podcast and I'd be okay with that. You should all go watch Severance. It's very, very good.
That's my intro. I have nothing else to talk about. Severance is the best. Go watch
it.
Mark
leaves.
It's on Apple. It's relevant to this podcast because if you bought a PS5 and you open up Apple TV, it will give you a free 6-month trial, which is more than enough time to watch Severance because I watched it in an afternoon.
They also recently started a free trial on PS4 even. So doesn't matter what PlayStation generation you have. You can watch Severance and you should. That's our PSA for the week. Thank you, Mark. Mm-hmm. Anyway, we're also joined this week by Jada Griffin.
All I care is seeing chaos destroyed.
Oh, no. Chaos. It's gotten to her, too.
Chaos.
We're going to be talking about chaos quite a bit later, I think, and I'm excited to dive into that conversation beyond just the memes, but it should be a fun one. We're also joined this week by special guest Seth Macy. Seth, welcome to the show.
Why, thank you. It's a pleasure to be back. The last time I was on, we were in studio, and I was only on for 5 minutes because I got called into a meeting.
That sounds like an office sort of situation. Absolutely. Yeah. Well, Seth, we're happy to have you back this week.
Happy to be here.
For those, of course, who don't, you should go check out the show that Seth hosts, Nintendo Voice Chat, if you're a big Nintendo fan as well. It's a wonderful show. You've been doing a wonderful job with it, and it's great to have you here as well.
No, you.
Oh, you.
You.
And then you can also catch us together on another show.
We got to do some live tech here. Seth seems very quiet to me. I don't know if that's the same as for everybody else, but he seems very quiet to me. That or just Dornbush is insanely loud, which could also be a thing.
I did have a full cup of coffee this morning.
No, Jada sounds fine as well. Seth just sounds a little quiet. We don't have to stop the show. I was just letting our producer know that Seth seems a little quiet. I was just helping everybody.
Seth, how dare you?
That is not like me at all.
There we go. Well, with that said, and I don't know if there's any mic things that can be done, but as we go into the show, we'll find out. I did want to, of course, mention we're recording the show on Wednesday. There is a State of Play taking place tomorrow, Thursday, March 17th. We're obviously recording before then, so we're not covering it this week. But you can go check out probably coverage on IGN.com and obviously YouTube and everywhere it is streaming. But for now, we've got plenty of news and plenty of games to talk about this week, so we're going to be jumping into that. Before we get into what we've been playing, because we've got sort of a wide gamut of all the big releases of March, both for PS4 and PS5 that we're going to be talking about. Did want to briefly just mention MPD, and then a little bit of extra detail also came out about this. MPD for February was released. MPD covers the North American sales of games, both hardware, software, and accessories. So obviously this is not a worldwide look, but we did get info from that month, and we learned that Elden Ring was the best-selling game of the month, and Horizon was the second best-selling game of the month. Elden Ring was the best-selling game of 2022 by far, so far, and I believe was the fifth or the biggest selling like game launch month other than Call of Duty Vanguard in the last 12 months. Somewhere in that top group. I need to check the exact number. But Horizon Forbidden West was also the number one game sold on PlayStation in February. So even though Elden Ring was number one overall, Horizon was the number one game on PlayStation, which would make sense because as we've seen from like Steam charts and things like that, Elden Ring sold very, very well on PC, so it's not surprising there. And we also learned, though we haven't gotten exact sales numbers from PlayStation, they obviously put that stuff out when they choose to. We do know that Elden Ring has sold 12 million copies worldwide, so both seem to be doing very well. This is definitely, I think, the biggest FromSoft launch of all time. We have a new story up sort of comparing their past launch month sales, and this just trounces everything. So I think it's safe to say the FromSoft games have gone from a bit of a niche to quite mainstream at the moment. It's very awesome to see that transition happen. But things are good all around. You know, Horizon selling that well is not a surprise either. It was selling very well on the PlayStation digital download charts as well. Good month for two very big games. I honestly was not sure how it would eke out, and I think it's awesome to see both selling so well and setting new records and all of that. Don't know if anyone has any specific sales thoughts. Seth, I know you used to cover when we both did news a lot, MPD.
I love me some NPDs. I don't know why, but I just do. But I got to say, I'm not surprised that Elden Ring is such a success. And I say that kind of anecdotally, but this is the first From Software game that I've actually stuck with. Normally, I bounce off them in about an hour, and Elden Ring really grabbed me. And were it not for the game that I'm going to be talking about later, I would still be playing. But it has been unseated.
Yeah, it certainly seems that you're not the only case of that I've heard. So, yeah, it certainly explains why we're seeing this after all the anticipation for Elden Ring, the continued success of it. And so it's awesome to see. It's a very busy month. And, you know, if you have two massive open world games to play going forward, don't worry about having beaten both of them in the 2 weeks that since they've come out. There's plenty of time to catch up.
If you're casual. Yeah,
there we go. That all said, very, very good sales success for both. So congrats to both Guerrilla and FromSoft for that huge success. Moving on from there, just wanted to mention we're slowly starting to get a look at what the summer event season is or isn't going to look like in this case. And we got word that EA Play is not going to be happening this summer. Normally EA, they sort of went E3 adjacent and basically took place right around the same week as E3. It would be usually the weekend before for the last few years. They would do their own live show off-site from E3. Even though it was essentially like a building across from E3 for those who are curious about the real world versions of it. But EA won't be doing that this time. They said they're kind of going to be showing their games off when they're ready and when it makes sense to. And I think, you know, we're seeing these now pretty frequent Dead Space streams. We've gotten two. We're getting another in May, so we're getting them every couple of months. And we got a early 2023 release window for Dead Space. We have Star Wars Celebration coming up, and that's where Jedi Fallen Order 1 was shown off, so that feels like a good candidate for any other, you know, follow-up to that. And their sports games kind of tend to come out and do well no matter what, so it kind of makes sense to me, but I feel like we're shaping up for a strange summer of showcases.
The summer is going to be weird this year when it comes to, because they haven't confirmed E3, or it's been confirmed it's not happening. I can't remember right now off the top of my head. I actually really was one of the people that enjoyed the EA Play showcase, but it was mostly selfishly because I really like just the really goofy Apex trailers and stuff they usually show during those periods of time. And I play a lot of Apex, so I'm always excited to see that stuff. Plus, when I got to go, there was always Apex swag that I couldn't get like on the online store. So being able to get some cool swag for my favorite games, it's always a win for me. So sad it won't be there, but I didn't think it was going to be an in-person thing this year anyways. So
yeah, as of right now, I believe the E3, the latest official update was that they were not doing an in-person show, and they have not said whether or not they're doing a digital show. They've left it up in the air. Obviously, we're only a couple months out, so we should probably be hearing within the next couple of weeks if they have any plans. But yeah, it's going to be strange. I think, you know, we've seen, especially just to bring it back to the show, PlayStation has not been at E3 the last few years, even before E3 took a year off. And I wouldn't expect them to come back even if E3 does a thing this year. I looked back at our calendar and they have had shows. They have had their big showcases in May and September the last few years. So if you're looking for a big PlayStation showcase, those are probably the months to put your hopes on.
Yeah. But yeah. This whole E3 stuff is kind of a bummer, only because like I've been with IGN since 2015. And I've been to every E3 since until, you know, pandemic wise. And like, I don't know, I'm really missing the hype that usually happens. And I know we do our summer of gaming and then Jeff does his summer game fest stuff. So it's like, I don't know, I'm used to that cycle of summer being this huge hype event, and then the winter comes and we get to play all the games. And so this whole like doling out thing is like, it's fine. But like, I miss the hype. I'm just going to say that.
Yeah, I'm with Mark. I went to one E3 in 2018, which was the last one that PlayStation was at, actually.
Yeah.
And it was awesome. And it was like a lifelong dream come true. I almost ran into Andrew WK. Like literally I turned around and he was standing there. I'm with Mark. Like, I love the hype and the energy about it, and like it all in one place. And it was just sort of, you know, I know it's a trade show and there are like rooms full of people from like Target and JCPenney hashing it out with distributors, but it's like a huge celebration and it's so cool and so fun. And I miss it and I wish it would come back in a real form, but we got PAX East, which is okay.
It's coming up. Yeah, but we've talked about E3 a lot in the past few years on this show. And I think, you know, Seth, you being at that 2018 one, that was that was a really great E3, I thought. And then 2019, yeah, when everyone started to pull out, like, you could feel the hollowness of the show floor. Well, and it was a bummer.
Yeah, even in 2018, like, PlayStation was there. They had a huge area, but it was empty. There was nothing in it. It was so bizarre. There was just people were just sitting on the floor because it was a comfortable place where there was nothing else happening.
Yeah, I think it's something that, unfortunately, like, the cat's out of the bag. And now that companies have found success with doing all this, we're probably not going to ever go back to a place where E3 is the single destination. But, you know, like, to your point, Mark, I agree. I think, like, the cadence of having all these things, it both forces, or it doesn't force, but it both creates this feedback cycle of, like, everyone puts their expectations on each showcase being the biggest thing of all time. Yeah. And then when it isn't, because there's four or five of them from each company potentially a year, it can be a bummer, even though that's not the intention of all of these anymore. But yeah, we don't have that sort of centralized. I think Gamescom is probably the closest still. Yeah. Gamescom has sort of started to become bigger. But that coming at the tail end of August, followed by literally the last 3 years, a State of Play or a big PlayStation showcase has happened in September. And then Nintendo Direct, even that weird year where they only had like a third party Direct sort of unexpected thing. September has now become kind of a big month because it sets you up for the rest of the fall. But yeah, we don't quite have that summer lull of releases, but big hype news at the moment. And it'll be curious to see how it plays out this year. Other than that, though, I think that was all the biggest news from this week. I am trying to make sure I did not forget anything on the PlayStation side this morning, so please let me know if I did. But other than, I did want to briefly mention, since they do have PlayStation history, the Until Dawn creator, Supermassive Games, announced a new game called The Quarry, which is coming this summer, being published by 2K. It does not seem to be one of their Dark Pictures games because those are published by Bandai Namco. This seems to be its own sort of thing. It looks to be a little bit of a mix of kind of the horror and campiness of Until Dawn, so I have hopes for it, whereas like the Dark Pictures stuff has been a little more serious. But look out for that one. That could be a potentially fun, spooky summer game to play. But other than that, I did want to mention, because we, you know, with our sort of off cycle schedule last week, we didn't get to give Jada the floor, and Seth, obviously, if you want to jump in here as well.
Yes.
There was a reveal at the PlayStation State of Play last week that got a lot of attention. Admittedly, I think was the biggest reveal on IGN.com. I think it had the biggest traffic of any of the news stories, and it was the TMNT collection. And Mark and I both admitted on the show to being like, oh, that's a cool thing for fans of those games. I never really played any of them, so it didn't matter to me as much. But Jada, I'm going to start with you, because based on what you're wearing, I'm going to guess you at least know one of the Ninja Turtles. And you're muted now, so I can't hear you.
I want to say one of the ones' name is they're artists, right? So,
Dolly,
Raffalonio,
Jonatello.
Jonatello, Jonatello, Leodongo, and
I don't know if that one works.
And Mickey Rightio, Mickey Mouse, Mickey Mouseio.
Is he the party dude?
He is definitely the party dude. He only eats chili dogs. But that's totally a lot of natural. Like,
it's no, a lot of character building.
We're all experts of TMNT lore, it seems.
Jada, go ahead. I am a massive TMNT fan. I've been watching and playing TMNT since I was old enough to hold a controller. But yes, no, TMNT, like I said, I was a huge Hyperstone Heist fan. I actually still have my original cartridge.
Nice.
I've been a huge TMNT fan since back when they were just comics and they were ultra brutal. Obviously I saw the cartoons first because I was like four or five when I was watching them, and I found the comics later in life, but they're great. This collection's amazing. Turtles in Time is great. I'm not downplaying Turtles in Time in any way. I was a Sega Genesis home, not a Super Nintendo home, so Hyperstone is what I got. But that was the one I went to most of the time. I love the arcade, obviously. I've gotten down to, when I go and play it in arcades, I can clear the campaign in 3/4 now.
Whoa.
It's very difficult, and I have to do it solo, because if I have anybody else there, it takes away the like points, which means you don't get the extra lives you need when you need them.
Oh, dang.
So,
I mean, in this economy, you kind of have to like be able to beat the game that fast. Three quarters, you know.
Yes.
It's like a full tank of gas now. What is
that? Yeah. People wish.
Oh, my goodness. I know, right? But yeah, no, it's great. I remember, Seth, you guys were talking about it on NVC last week about the Game Boy one with the like abnormally large sprites. I actually had that one back on the Game Boy, and I got it with my first Game Boy from my uncle, and I ended up dropping it off my top bunk because I was playing in bed overnight and it cracked the screen. And all I had was this like very tiny little corner in the bottom right corner of the screen that worked. And I would play the game trying to get through with that. I managed to clear one level, and I couldn't remember past that first level. It was painful. I was like, I need a new Game Boy. I had to beg my parents for a new Game Boy, which was just not a normal thing for me to get extra stuff like that growing up. Like it was limited. but I love that. I played the original arcade one back in the day, like that algae level. Everybody will remember that from the very first one.
The NES one.
Yeah, the NES one. Very brutal. The trick is just sacrifice all the turtles but Donatello and you're good. As long as you keep Donatello alive after that level, you should be able to save the rest of them. And hopefully
if you're still trying to beat TMNT for NES,
there's your tip. That I mean, people will that's be. That's my hot so, tip. You know. Fighters is great. There's just so many good TMNT games. I'm really hoping we get some type of a new TMNT game coming in this decade sometime. I know
we've got
been all
Shredder's
the...
Revenge, right?
Oh, that too. That's new. Yes. So Shredder's Revenge is gonna be great. Forgot about that one off the top of my head. I was talking more about like the rumors around like the Rocksteady building a TMNT game that's been going around for years. That would be amazing. I would love some 4-player Rocksteady style gameplay with the Ninja Turtles.
Based on how long Suicide Squad took them, I think you can look forward to that in like 2032, unfortunately.
PlayStation 6 exclusive.
If we're lucky, 6. But yeah. Shredder's Revenge looks great too. And so I do want to go back to these older games as well. Mm-hmm. And your hype for them has me more interested. I used to watch the cartoons all the time, but I just never played the games for some reason. They just like
games are so good.
One second.
I played Super Nintendo one, Turtles in Time.
That's the best one.
That's the one I've played the most, and that game is awesome. Like there are just like sound cues in that game that are like stuck in my brain forever. Like when you're doing the surfing in the sewers, and he's like, my toe.
That's exactly what Tom Marks was saying on NBC. He has like those little my toe, and shell shocked, and
burned into your brain. Like it's ridiculous.
I did realize I don't have any memory of ever playing this, but I guess I was somewhat lying. I guess I have played a Ninja Turtles game because I have my mom's old NES and a couple of the games that we had for it. And I do have this TMNT.
That is such a good NES game. Turtles 2, the arcade game.
So I should play
this,
I guess.
Yep.
Yes.
Absolutely should.
Yep.
Anyway, we did miss out on talking about that one too much last week. So I did want to jump in there. And Jada, as you mentioned, Seth, you guys talked about it a bit on NVC as well, correct?
Yeah, we wanted Jada to come on, but unfortunately, I believe you had a meeting.
I did. It was an external outside of IGN meeting, too. So it's one of those ones you can't like generally like reschedule. I was meeting with like teams from Tel Aviv and Israel and a whole bunch of other. Yeah, it was just like I can't really move this meeting when I've got 4 countries waiting on me.
Well, talk about Ninja Turtles.
If you want to hear about Ninja Turtles, I think like half our show of NBC.
Oh my gosh.
Like we just talked about it, Ninja Turtles. We were very excited.
Yeah, but thumbnail was Ninja Turtles and we talked about it for 30 seconds. So
yes. It's because it had the best art.
It did definitely have the best art. But you know, shout out to in the community, Jonathon Rendon was like, would have liked more conversation about TMNT. There you go, buddy. And you got a shout out. So just saying, we listen to our commenters. I'm in there every week chatting. And I know Seth is for the NVC cast.
That is true.
So definitely drop us good comments and we'll maybe your wishes will be granted.
Yeah. Well, when the TMNT collection comes out, I'm excited to hear how everything plays from your perspective and how it plays from people who perhaps haven't played all the games. Talk about me, apparently, even though I played one of those games. But speaking of playing games, we actually do have a lot of big releases from this month. You know, we talked a lot about how February, we had some really big heavy hitters with Horizon and Elden Ring toward the end of the month, and then Sifu at the beginning of the month. And then March has just been this kind of consistent trickle of games. We have several games that have been out this month already, and next week, just looking ahead, we already have a couple other games. So we're going to jump in kind of throughout the month, a look at some of the games, and we're actually going to start in the middle of the month, aka this week, because it's the most recent thing that we published a review for to talk about on the show, and we happen to have the reviewer on this show. Oh my goodness.
Wait, what? We do? Who's that?
Stranger of Paradise Final Fantasy Origin.
I legit had no idea what we were talking about. I was like, I know we were gonna talk about Gran Turismo, and I was like, did Seth review Gran Turismo? That was a strange choice. I'll be honest, I completely forgot Strange of Paradise was a thing. Sorry, Jada.
Well, it was. Jada reviewed it, and of course the demo is also out there for people to play at the beginning of the game. Your progress carries over if you've been playing that way, but you've of course played the full thing. Obviously people can go check out your great review both in written and video form on IGN.com and the video on youtube.com/IGN. But do you want to start off just by giving us kind of your like top level thoughts about the game?
Yeah. So basically, you know, it's kind of like the intro paragraph to my review, but Stranger of Paradise. I have to really catch myself from saying strangers. I keep wanting to say Strangers of Paradise, and it's just
me too.
Singular, yeah. Not.
I couldn't find the demo because it wouldn't pop up because I'm like Strangers of Paradise. And I'm like, what people are playing this? Why is this not popping up?
Yeah,
there's only one stranger. There's not several.
There's only one stranger. Narratively, it makes sense. Like as you get further into the game, but it's basically kind of not a retelling, not a prequel. It's kind of a prequel, but it kind of fills in some gaps around the Final Fantasy I story that most people don't know of, or it's just, you know, that they've taken the liberty to tell this story, following this main character, Jack, and the role he plays in the first Final Fantasy in the Warriors of Light. So it's kind of like seeing what Final Fantasy I kind of might have looked like in 2022 versus its 1987 original release, just with a different gameplay style. Obviously, it's real-time action versus turn-based. It's done by the Koei Tecmo Team Ninja team, so, you know, the action is solid, the gameplay mechanics, combos, the customization in combat. If you've played Neo and like Neo, you'll probably like this. The job system is fan-freaking-tastic. Ooh. There's 28 different jobs to switch between. You can equip two at a time, so you're multi-classing. I generally, once I got all the classes unlocked, I stuck with Sage and Dragoon, because being a Dragoon and being able to jump around the battlefield is freaking fantastic. And you can stay in the air forever, almost. It's kind of ridiculous how high you can jump. And Sage gives you access to black and white magic, so heals and DPS, which is always very welcome.
Is there a red mage?
There is a red mage class,
that's
yes.
That's the best class of all.
Red mage is a great class. It has their power isn't as high as any of the other mages' classes, but they have the fastest casting. So nice. You can like chain cast like six thunder spells.
Do they have a jaunty hat with a feather in it?
There, yes, that is actually
yes. Okay, well, regular. I'm buying yes. this now. So
yes,
okay,
they have it. I think it comes in red and in purple. They have that same kind of hat. It's gotta got that. There's also that. They also have like that kind of very Sinatra kind of like hat. Which is kind of crazy, which is, you know, like they use
a fedora.
Yeah, like the fedora.
M'lady.
like a sir.
The Frank Sinatra connections for this game just are endlessly delightful. But
yes, and honestly, the song, I was so baffled by why they went with that song for this game, but it totally makes sense once you finish the game. Like it, I was like, oh, okay, well that totally makes sense why they went with that. It fits thematically for the game. But yeah, no, it's really good. Co-op is great. I was actually hopped on with my max gear scored character last night and helping some newbies clear through the dungeon with or the level with Tiamat as the boss. And I just sat back just casting Cure, Protect, Shell, Haste, Regan, oh, you died. Let me revive you. And just like, also, I was like, you guys have to do the damage and fight this boss, because otherwise I will literally just one shot him at my level, because it's very gear based. But it was a lot of fun just seeing people.
Sorry,
I put in. Ahead. Yeah, no, I put in. You're going to say how many hours I put into it.
Yeah,
I put about 30 hours to clear the campaign with side quests, co-op, bunch of other stuff. Put another 15 or 20 hours after that, just kind of like game capture, practicing a few things to make sure things worked how I was talking about them. And then over the weekend, wrote the review, I put another 40 hours in over the weekend, just getting to max level. Because once you clear the game, you unlock a chaos difficulty. You know, chaos.
Of course you do.
Yeah, of course it's called chaos. It takes the mission's difficulty from, like, when I cleared the game, I think the final mission was like 130 was like the highest like gear score where they wanted you to be around that level. And then on the chaos difficulty, it maxes out at 300. So the monsters scale up. So I got to I'm at 297 right now. You have to clear like 300 missions, like the mission, not 300 missions, but missions at level 300 to unlock level 300 gear, which is some of the best gear. So like I have like level 300 gauntlets, which are the God Hands, which is, you know, pretty cool name. Also tribute to God Hand, the old game. Plus, I'm pretty sure there's Final Fantasy weapon called God Hand. In one of the older ones. Can't remember.
There's also that review gets brought up every time we give something a low score.
God Hand?
God Hand in the comments, yeah. That was like 12 years ago or something. But
it is much better than that. I really enjoyed it. Like the graphics, it's not the best graphical game graphically. The level design is a little simple, but the gameplay is fantastic. The story is nonsense until the end, which was kind of crazy. I was really surprised, like no joke. I was probably like 15 hours in. I was like, this story makes no gosh darn sense. Like, I don't care about any of these people. I don't care about anything. And literally the last like 5 hours is like, oh, okay. That makes sense. All right. And that's why that was like that. Okay. That makes sense now. And so like, I really enjoyed the ending, the payoff for all the buildup that they did really worked for me.
Sounds like a classic Final Fantasy. You got to play 60 hours before it gets good.
So story wise, yes, but the gameplay is good from the jump. Like I really like the gameplay right off the bat. Like even when you're at the start and you have very few classes, just kind of discovering what combos and stuff and how you can swap classes mid combo to extend your combos. And you can pretty much do that endlessly as long as you have enough MP and you gain MP per hit. So generally, if you can one chain lots of enemies, not bosses because they jump around a lot and move around, but it's great. I really like it.
I was gonna say I've been playing the demo and I feel that like elasticity in the combat. It definitely is something like just even being able to switch on the fly, like you were saying, between classes or the jobs lets you just keep finding new ways to go at creatures, even if you're going at the same small ones, you know, throughout that demo a little bit. But I totally am there right now where I was also like, I'm having fun playing this. This doesn't look the best, but I also just like, the story for me, it's so hard for it not to be rooted in the memes that I've seen of like obviously him listening to like Limp Bizkit or things like that. But I think the thing for me at the beginning, it was just kind of like the three characters who are your starting party meet, they skip like weeks of their time together. So then they're best friends. They then go on a journey together that seems very different from the last journey. But they still don't seem like very good friends. I just was like, I don't know why any of this is happening right now. And I kind of was like,
what in the Final Fantasy 15 is this?
Well, I haven't played 15. So that also, like, I don't have a point of comparison.
Yeah, the characters are very bland. Like, they're not going to be up there at the top with the Clouds, the Squalls, the Yunas, the Titus, or Titus, however you want to prefer it. I know Titus is the proper way, but I always called it Titus growing up.
I think it's Titus.
So it's Titus. It is. But, you know, when you have something burned in your brain and you want to say, when you're young and you just like, this is how I read it.
I have that with Kingdom Hearts, and I got a lot of flack for it in a video once because I saw one of the main villains in Chain of Memories. I always knew their name as Marluxia because I just thought you pronounced the X that way, but it's Marluxia. Marluxia. And I had no idea, so I pronounced it as Marluxia, and that was not a good thing that I did.
That's how my brain took it as a kid playing it, and like back in what, 2004, 2003? I can't remember.
the version of Final Fantasy X I bought came with a book that, you know, when games came with books back then, and it came with, like, you know, the character biographies or something like that. And the one I had said, you know, our hero Tidus, pronounced T-E-E-D-U-S. And I was like, okay, so, like, technically, yeah, that's just like copywriting from like a Japanese to English kind of thing. Like, it doesn't necessarily make it 100% canon, but like, it's in the book.
Yeah.
Also,
well, and to be fair, to prefer to bleh, to be fair, I in Japanese is pronounced E, so it would be Tidus if you're reading the Japanese translation of it. So
that's all I needed to hear.
Yeah. So like, it is correct to say Tidus, but Titus is just how I prefer it, and so that's how I'm going to refer to him, because I don't think they ever say his name in 10, if I remember correctly. They don't.
Well,
ever.
No, because in 10, that was the last Final Fantasy that you could rename him. So you can.
Oh, that's true. He doesn't have.
This is just a Final Fantasy 10 podcast now. You can just make his name whatever, and then 11 was an MMO, and then 12, like, you know, he's Vaughn, and the rest is history.
Can I make a confession? Until like 5 minutes ago, I didn't know it was not Titus. So there we go.
There you go.
That's my goal on Beyond, is to always teach someone something new about Final Fantasy X.
Yeah. But yeah, probably my favorite thing about playing through Stranger Paradise, besides the combat, was the levels, not the design. Like the level design for how you get from point A to point B, but just the environment and the art direction that they went, because just about every stage is pulled from a different Final Fantasy game. So, and like, I was looking at every stage. I'm like, what game is this from? Like, there, you'll see in my review, like, you'll see like the Mako reactors from Final Fantasy VII is in there. You'll see the Cavern of Earth dungeon from Final Fantasy I is remodeled after the, oh my goodness, I'm forgetting what it's called. It's the it's that very first like real big dungeon in Final Fantasy 12 where it has the walls with the claws that come after you and try to knock you off the ledge. I cannot remember the name of that, and I'm mad because I wrote it down. but yeah, it has that. There's one that takes inspiration from Final Fantasy 11. There's a pirate cove that takes inspiration from Final Fantasy 14. It's the Sestasha dungeon. That one I remember. And so, but there's so many good levels that are just really cool to figure out, like, oh, that came from this. But yeah, it's really good. It's a treat for if you're a fan of Final Fantasy and you like action games like Neo, with a little bit of a Souls that have like that little bit of a Souls DNA, you'll probably like Stranger of Paradise. So just don't get bogged down on being a graphic snob and you'll be fine.
Yeah, it is definitely not, I would say, up to, you know, even 7 remake.
No, not at all. But
it is definitely a game that as I was playing, I was like, I'm really enjoying this. I think if I tried to stare too much at the screen and try to figure out all the detail of everything, that's not kind of the point of it. It's a bummer because I do think, like, as you were saying, even just from the beginning, there's a lot of variety that you can find to the world. So I do wish it had that graphical bump, but the gameplay itself is really solid. And if people want more info from Jada on it, they should definitely go check out the full written and video review because it was great.
Thank you.
Moving on from there to talk about another game, since we got a few to knock off the list, I do want to mention the latest Gran Turismo has been out for a few weeks now. And we've been meaning to talk about it on the show, but things kept happening. But luckily, we have a Gran Turismo expert here. Mark, take it away.
Vroom, vroom. You know, cars, they go fast sometimes and you can drive them.
There you go. No, Seth, thank you. Thank you for joining us this week to talk about Gran Turismo 7. Oh, you know, it's been out for a few weeks.
Pleasure.
I know you've been loving it, and so I do want to hear your thoughts on it. But just before you dive into what you've been enjoying about it, just also give a little bit of background for kind of like where you're coming from sure, a like Gran Turismo history of it.
Well, I played Gran Turismo 1, 2, 3, and 4. And as far as 2, 3, and 4 are concerned, I played those like whatever the day was that they came out. Gran Turismo, the original one on PlayStation 1, was not something I was aware of. I wasn't really interested in racing games other than Ridge Racer, which is a very arcadey racing game, until I was, you know, at a friend's and he was playing it and I was just blown away. Like the replays looked like actual race footage. If you watch it now, it super doesn't. But in whatever, 1998 or something, it looked, it was like the most realistic looking car racing game I had ever seen. And it is, it advertises itself as a car racing simulation, but it has this this sort of magic to it that keeps it, it gives it a little, yeah, there's Ridge Racer right there.
It is. It looks so real.
It looks real. There's the, I'm trying to, you know, a lot of simulations, like I love simulations, like don't get me wrong, but they lack personality. They sort of get bogged down in the details, whereas Gran Turismo somehow can do both. Like it can really get bogged down in the details, but it also has this just like this charm to it that I love. And you can tell that the creator is a super, just this loves cars. And I remember reading like an EGM back in the late 90s, an interview with a creator whose name is escaping right now, and this is basically just like a dream project because he loves cars so much. So yeah, I played 1, 2, 3, and 4, and then I didn't have a PlayStation 3 and I never played Gran Turismo Sport, so I was very excited when this one came out. I got it last weekend and Elden Ring went out the window. I stopped playing that entirely, and now this is all I play, and this is all I want to play. It's all I want to talk about. It's all I think about. I love Gran Turismo 7. It is fantastic and it is so fun, and I cannot for the life of me get the gold medal in the A8 license dirt track test with a Toyota Tundra. I cannot do it, and it is driving me absolutely crazy. That's, it is so harder specific. Than any of the bosses in Elden Ring. I am
it's the Dark Souls of car games.
It is the Dark Souls of car games. That's one of the things, is they've sort of smoothed a lot of the edges off of Gran Turismo over the years. Like the first one, you couldn't do anything until you passed the license tests. Like you could not play any of the game, and it was really frustrating, and the barrier to entry was like really high. And now you can, you know, jump in and you can start playing, but to get to the later stuff you do have to get those licenses. Of course, I went through and I got all the licenses before I did any of the actual gameplay, so yes, I have my super license. And so now I'm going back trying to,
if you need a gold star that one race, just don't bang your head up against the wall. Go and explore, do all the other races, level up a bit, and then come back and fight that race, and you'll be surprised.
Yeah, I just have to keep rolling out of the way. Yeah. Just
keep dodge rolling around.
Yeah, exactly. Have you tried getting a better sword?
I did not try that.
Upgrading your wheels at the smithing stone.
Maybe I need to respec.
But no, just to your point, Seth, I also was looking it up. Most likely, I think the longtime producer that you were probably reading an interview from would have been Kazunori Yamauchi.
Yes.
Who I know did a few interviews and like preview stuff with Luke, and you can check all that coverage out on IGN. But yeah, this is, I think that's the thing about Gran Turismo that has made me decide like to finally jump into it, is sort of like, I am not someone who knows car culture very well, but there's clearly such a love of it behind it. And it seems like GT7 is also really trying to showcase that love and tell you why car culture is so interesting and fascinating to the developers. Put that front and center
there. Yeah. And it's more than just like a representation. Like there's actual chunks, like little bits of history on every car manufacturer that's in the game. Like you can basically read a Wikipedia article about the history of like Bugatti, or you know, like the origins of like Fiat and things like that. Like Forza Horizons is like a celebration of automobiles, but this is like an homage to just like car culture. It is just it is so good. And actually playing Gran Turismo 7,
what was that B-roll?
I don't know what that was, because you can't crash like that, I don't think. But
I think that might have been showing a bug.
Okay.
But yeah.
It reminds me of what like I originally sort of fell in love with PlayStation in the first place. It was games like Gran Turismo, because back then this didn't exist on any other console. There was no other game like Gran Turismo that took the subject matter so seriously and so intricately, you know, laid out the physics and the tuning. You know, that's an important part. I was banging my head against the wall trying to win this race, and it turned out I had to sort of tune my transmission so I had, you know, a more on the higher end because it was a longer track, and I was losing because the other car, you can really nerd out with this game. And it's absolutely beautiful. It is one of the most beautiful car games ever created, and I am playing it on PlayStation 5, and the DualSense integration is the most incredible thing I have felt on a game console since like the first time I played analog. It is so incredible the way those triggers respond. Like if you break traction, the trigger, you feel breaking traction with the trigger. It's so impossible to like really explain it. Or you're driving in the Tokyo levels and, you know, it's on a highway and those highways have seams so they can expand. When you drive over them, you feel every bump. Boom, boom, boom. And it is oh my God, it is so cool. I'm really excited to try this out with like a racing wheel. But I mean, if you don't have a racing wheel, the DualSense is just amazing. It is such an incredible way to play this game. I love it so much. I wish I were, I mean, no offense to you all, but I wish I were playing it right now.
No, I hear you. I wish
I was doing anything else as well.
Trust me. Oh my God.
Great. What a great, wow. He just signed
off. I turned off his camera because. Yeah.
After that sort of comment, I get
yes,
it.
Yeah. Yes. Seth, you were saying it's super pretty and I agree. It's looked gorgeous in all the trailers. Have you messed around in the photo mode at all?
I did a little bit of the photo mode, and
I think my camera actually died, and it died at the funniest moment ever.
In time for your goose, it actually died.
Right in time for me saying, I don't want to be here, my camera died.
I thought you were doing a bit.
But yeah, Seth, you were saying the photo mode, you've messed around a little bit with it?
Yeah, the photos that you can take in the photo mode, they look photorealistic. They look like actual locations, actual cars. As far as the Forza photo mode is much better. I'll just say that. Oh. Like, I don't really like the... Because in Forza, you can just stop the game wherever you are and just do a 360-degree view and, you know, do whatever you need to do to get the picture that you want wherever you want. There's a great picture of Mark that just popped back up.
Very accurate.
But... You know, and it might be something that I unlock later, you know, because I haven't unlocked everything in the game. But for now, it's just like you place your car on a scene and you can move the car around a little bit. You can add other cars. You can bring things to the fore. And it has all the normal photo controls. So aperture, you know, shutter speed, focal length, things like that. But it's not as exciting as I was hoping it was. It takes some very beautiful pictures, however, and that might be part of why it's not linked to the actual game itself, because the pictures that you take, they look completely realistic. So
gotcha. Yeah. Okay.
And yeah, I love a photo mode. So
yeah, it's a bummer that it doesn't have the kind of the more controls. Like it's one of those things. I don't know if I've talked about it on the show. Like, we talk about so many things that I tend to forget about stuff as Crash gets bigger and bigger. Speaking of photos, and it's just, it amazes me how like some photo modes get things so right. Like Spider-Man has, you can add lightings and move your lighting and change everything. You can change your suit inside the photo mode. There's like so many options. I think Spider-Man has probably done photo mode the best out of any game I've played so far. And if somebody else has recommendations for other ones for me to go try, please send those to me. Send them to me in the comments.
I'll send you one right now. Yeah. I won't even go to the comments. Ghost of Tsushima has the best photo mode of any game ever created. Ghost hands down. And I say that as a hobbyist photographer for the last 10 years. Like, Ghost of Tsushima's photo mode is unbelievable. I barely played the game because I was too busy taking pictures. So
I spent a whole lot of time with Ghost. So I totally agree. I think Ghost may actually be the better photo mode. Just because I know you can add all those effects and you can change the degree of the effects. You know, you're right. I'm gonna change it. Ghosts is the best one. So if anybody has one better than Ghosts, please send me those comments.
It. Not possible.
Go ahead, Jonathon.
I was just gonna say, my hope would be, and obviously they're all building games on different engines and doing things like that, but I do hope we get to a point where all the PlayStation first party games can share the learnings of their photo modes, because some, like, I do think probably Ghost is the best overall, but I do think Spider-Man's has a few things that Ghost doesn't that I like using in there as well. And so I hope there's just a point where we get to where all of them have kind of all of the features that make the most sense. But obviously they're building different tools, they're trying different things out. But and that seems to be the case again with GT7.
It's those cool lights, man. They need to add more of that. The lights that are in Spider-Man.
The lights not being in Horizon was definitely a bummer. I wanted to use radial lighting more a little bit there. But just to wrap up the GT7 thoughts, Seth, obviously you're coming from a place of I wouldn't say fully like lapsed, but you did skip a couple of GTs throughout the years. But how are, like, obviously you clearly love it as like a longtime fan. Do you feel like it's a good introductory point for people as well who maybe have wanted to try GT in the past but just never did?
The biggest problem with Gran Turismo games is that they're pretty difficult to get into. And I would say that this one is not really any exception, because it requires, to get the licenses, it requires actual like driving skills. And there's a million assists that you can turn on. But even with the assists, like if you're not hitting those lines and you're not breaking at just the right time or hitting the gap, you're not going to pass those license tests. Like me with A8 beginner's dirt track, I cannot get that 300ths of a second to beat it. But yeah, it's just so beautiful, though. I still would recommend, if you have any interest in cars, if you have interest in cars enough that you're going to want to do all those, you know, all the technical stuff anyway. It's
totally,
but it's for like if you're looking for like a casual racing game, this is not it. This is a simulation.
Mm.
Yeah, this one definitely seems, it's one of those things that I think kept me back from it previously, but I would like to try my hand at it just to see if it is a thing, because I don't know how to drive in real life. So it'll probably be the most learning.
Everything that you learn in this game applies to real life. And I only say this because after, you know, playing like Gran Turismo 2, when I was in the Air Force, my squadron, we went to this go-kart track, and the guy who ran it was like, you know what, I'm just going to turn the governors off. And so we were just flying around, and I was like, oh, if I hit the apex of this corner, like I won't fly into the wall. And like, yeah, this actually teaches you how to drive front wheel drive, rear wheel drive, front wheel or rear wheel, mid engines. Like there's all kinds of different handling, and you learn about all of it in this game.
There's so many times where I'm like, I need to get to McDonald's fast. I am so hungry. And I go out and I tune my acceleration and all that stuff. I tune my wheels. I let out some air, stuff like that. And that's
I will say the Tesla Roadster 2012 is a playable vehicle in this game. And I bought.
Oh, look at that. Try tuning its transmission.
Yeah, I don't know. I haven't done any tuning to it, so I don't know what.
Well, it doesn't have one. So,
well, I was going to say I come from the school of Mario Kart, so any actual closer to real world driving would probably be helpful in my.
That's case. What driving a Tesla is actually like. It's just like driving a glorified like golf cart.
Yes, there's a button that releases a banana peel.
Perfect. I mean, I'll look forward to that in the next model. But Seth, thank you for your thoughts on Gran Turismo 7. It's something we've been meaning to talk about for a little bit. I'm glad you're enjoying it as much as you are.
I love it so much.
I'm sorry we're keeping you from it, but
it's okay. I also have a job that I have to do today as well.
God. So annoying.
Job.
Anyway. Gran Turismo player. Oh well.
Exactly. We probably need help on the guide. I'm sure Sam could give you an excuse. Before we wrap up, though, I do want to mention another game that Mark, you and I have been playing, but I want to throw to you now that you're also back on camera with us.
I did.
You got to play sort of there's been a preview section of the early hours of Ghostwire Tokyo that we've been able to play, the opening couple chapters. You can go check out Tristan's proper full preview written and video version on IGN.com if you want his breakdown thoughts on the game so far. But Mark, how has that sort of opening hours of Ghostwire hit you? Of course, it's coming to PS5 and PC next week.
Yeah, Ghostwire Tokyo is an interesting game coming out at an interesting time. You try to do that like journalism thing where you don't compare it to all the other games coming out right now. But luckily for me, I am not a journalist, so I can compare it to anything. Yeah, it's an interesting one just because it's so much different than Horizon and Elden Ring, and the fact that it's. I'm not liking it as much as those two games so far, but I think there's definitely a game here that people will love, and I think I will eventually fall in love with it. Let's start with the good.
It's just worth saying your comparison point there is, for those who don't know, this is more of an open world game than you might be thinking. Like Tango previously did the Evil Within games, which are more linear. This is. It is at the beginning, you know, there's a little bit of story integration to get you into things, but it is an open world game. It opens up into being a open up the map, reveal points, go do side missions, go collect certain things.
Yeah, it can almost be compared to like that kind of Ubisoft style of thing where except for this one's a little different in the sense that like in a Ubisoft game, you unlock a tower so that way you can see more of the map. In this game, you unlock a tower because you physically can't go to those areas in the map until you've unlocked the tower. Like unlocking, they're called Turi Shrines, dissipates this fog that's there that you can't physically go to. So like in an Assassin's Creed, when you start the game, you can just run anywhere. This game does prevent you from that. So it is open world, but it starts very, very small. And you can only go because the story shrines are there. There's only like five of them to start with, maybe even less. And then as the story progresses, more and more will unlock, which means, OK, more of unlocks. So now I can go further in the map. But you can't just go anywhere from the start. So still open world. But yeah. But yeah, the good stuff is that it's like it's very flashy. I think it's well acted. It's one of those rare games that because it takes place in Tokyo and it's Japanese, the default setting is for it to have Japanese speaking with English subtitles. I will say I turned that off only because while that seems like the pure way to play, you miss a lot of dialogue having to read subtitles while you're in the middle of action. So it's basically how it is you have this being inside of you. His name's KK, and he's essentially Venom, right? He's always just talking to you. They highly recommend you play this game with a headset on, and it's because you hear that like inner dialogue all the time. And so he's constantly like, I don't mean constantly in a bad way, but he's like always telling you, you know, what to do, and he's cracking jokes and he's giving you story information. But if he's giving it to you in Japanese while you're playing, you have to then read subtitles while battling creatures. Like that's, I did not find that very easy to do. So I thought the English voice cast was also very well.
Does he talk about sending stuff to his stash?
He does not do that. There's no stash in this game.
I will say, just to give the opposite, I have been playing with Japanese VO still on, and I definitely have had those moments as a non, you know, native Japanese speaker where I probably have missed a line or two. Typically, if it's a very story big moment, I will like almost kind of stop myself from getting into anything so I can take everything in. But the Japanese VO is also very well delivered.
Yeah.
But yes, if you're not a native speaker to it, you are more likely going to be focusing on those when possibly you might be wanting to be in the midst of combat or trying to figure out your way around and stuff like that. So that is worth mentioning. Absolutely.
I can imagine a world where I would want to replay the game again with the Japanese, because there are certain characters that you meet later in chapter two that like, yeah, I know what the two main characters sound like in Japanese because I played a good portion of it with that way before I changed it to English. But then there was, you know, another new character that I met that I'm like, I kind of wonder what they sound like in Japanese. So that's, you know, I can picture myself wanting to replay the entire game again, more in the like, you know, creator's vision, I guess you could say. The world itself is like really pretty. I think it's a fully realized world, and it's strange because it's, you know, you've seen the trailers, you've seen the gameplay. It's not a bustling world where things are happening, and that's the point. There's just clothes everywhere because one mysterious thing happened and everybody disappeared, which adds a lot to like the ambiance and aesthetic to the game. You are alone and it's kind of creepy. If you can see on the screen right now, that's one of those like ghost parades. Those are terrifying. But yeah, it's a very creepy, uneasy game, but it also is not afraid to be a little silly. The vendors are all like, they're cats and they sing funny songs and stuff like that. And the characters themselves do crack jokes every so often. So I am really, really liking it so far.
Yeah.
But I would be remiss to not mention a few things that, you know, I just want to be honest with our audience. I think the combat is it looks cooler than it actually plays, only because like it looks really, really flashy. But once you get into it, you'll start to realize that it's incredibly basic. you have like four moves and each of them is just a very magical, flashy looking version of a gun. Like you have like a wind attack. It's just a pistol. You have a water attack. It's a shotgun. Like Tristan goes over all this in his preview if you want to check all that out. But so you find yourself trying to unlock skills and stuff like that. And I'm excited to unlock more skills. But the reason I'm excited is because the abilities are pretty lackluster and I'm just trying to make them interesting. That's what I very quickly discovered is you are shooting your pistol, you know, your wind attack, and it shoots very slow. So I'm very excited to be able to shoot it faster, you know, and so it's kind of stuff like that where I was like, it is what it is. And then my biggest frustration with it is there's no dodge ability. The only way to defend yourself is to hold L1 and he'll put up like a block. And it also has the ability to do like a quick parry where if you hold L1 at the last minute, you'll kind of like deflect their attack and stuff like that. So that's really your only means to defend yourself. So it's a lot of like almost like Fallout style where you're just like running backwards the entire time because it's the only way to get away from enemies. The game requires you to hold buttons a lot, but so I'll give you two examples of that. Every ability has you know, just your R2, just your shooting, but if you can hold it and it'll do something else. So like for the wind attack, it'll shoot a barrage of wind attacks that you unlock more skills and it'll shoot more. The water attack will do a bigger slice. And then there's like a fire attack that when you hold it, it shoots like a fire bomb. All of those require you to hold the button to shoot it. And you have to hold it for quite a long time until you activate more skills to make it where you don't have to hold it as long. But anything touches you interrupts that. So it's a lot of just like you're running backwards, holding R2 to do your special moves. And that's like, and then the other thing is there's like this finisher where when you've done enough damage to them, you can absorb their core. Again, to absorb the core, you hold L2 and he does this really cool like string attack, like he's absorbing their core. Anything touches you, that gets interrupted. And when you get interrupted from absorbing the core, they come back to life. So it really does become this frustrating dance of like trying to find time to like do these holds when in reality, all you're doing is you're just going to start spamming R2.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
I was just going to say, I haven't used like any charge attacks because you just don't have the time. Like I agree with you. Yeah. I think the combat is probably the most basic slash like least interesting part of what I've played so far. Like the world and the story and all of that is really, really cool. And I'm super into exploring it. But yeah, any combat situation, if there's more than three enemies, I basically am just walking backwards, slowly leading them away so they don't get up in my face.
Yeah. And so I've talked about this before on the show, and I know it's blasphemous on a PlayStation podcast, but yeah, I'm not a big fan of the adaptive triggers when they're not used in a way that I think for like a racing game, they're probably awesome. I'm playing Grand Theft Auto 5 right now and they've added adaptive triggers and I think it works really well. But for this game, it's one of those like every time you shoot the wind attack, it kind of works against you, right? Like, hey, look, we're adaptive. We're shooting a wind attack. When you're spamming a wind attack, that is not fun, right? This controller work against you. So for fellow people out there that don't want to deal with constant hand cramps, I turned off the adaptive triggers almost immediately.
Mark, yep. You gotta do the stretches.
I just don't want to play a game where my controller is like always working against me. I never turned them off for Horizon, and I've played 80 hours of Horizon. I thought they did it so well in Horizon that it doesn't like make you pull back a bowstring. There's just a tiny bit of resistance. This game goes a little too overboard, and so I turned them off.
Forearms are gonna be though after playing.
Is this game has 6 graphics options on PlayStation 5, which is insane. And they are as followed: quality, performance mode, high frame rate versions of both of those, which I thought performance mode was high frame rate, but there's HFR quality, HFR performance, and then there's HFR performance and quality with VSync enabled on both of those. This game has the patented Bethesda engine input lag that I really, really don't love. I'm really, really sensitive to input lag because I play a lot of games on PC on a 240 hertz monitor. So like when things have input lag, they really, really drive me crazy. Things like Deathloop and Wolfenstein 2 and stuff like that. So This game has that as well. So for the people out there that are very sensitive to input lag, high frame rate mode, performance mode with VSync enabled is that's the sweet spot right there. I've done a lot of testing.
That's very good to know. Also, unfortunately, Jada's internet just died. So if you notice that she has frozen or is unable to say anything toward the end of the show, that is why that's happening.
Hey, at least I stuck around. All I did was turn my camera off. The Ghostwire Tokyo blasphemy has ejected Jada from the internet.
There's a ghost in the literal wires.
just to like cap it off, I want to say that I am liking the game a lot. And then I find it totally refreshing that it's kind of straightforward after just the length that Horizon Forbidden West was, and then the vagueness of Elden Ring. No matter, you know, I love both of those games. Being able to kind of just jump into this like more straightforward game that doesn't seem like it's going to be overly long has been a breath of fresh air, and I'm liking it a lot, and I'm addicted to doing like all the side stuff. There's a lot of it and they're fun to do.
Yeah, just to cap it off before we wrap up, I totally agree. I think the world, it's, I've bounced off the last few Far Cries. I guess like that's the closest comparison for an open world first person game. I've bounced off them, not because they've been bad necessarily, but I just kind of have gotten overly familiar with their loop, and especially overly familiar with the way Ubisoft has now integrated their loop. And there are definitely exceptions. Like I loved Assassin's Creed Odyssey. I thought Immortals was actually really good. Like their open world stuff, it's not like a bad thing to me, but just the Far Cry games haven't grabbed me as much. But there's something I think about Tango making this, you know, Tokyo focused world that is both spooky but kind of light in interesting ways, that really dives into Japanese mythology and lore in, mm-hmm. in interesting ways, I think is made for a world that I'm interested in unlocking the fuller scope of. But I totally agree with you in terms of like the minute to minute of combat is, I think, the least interesting and the least deep system in the game, and it's a little bit of a bummer because, as you said, I think like it looks really flashy, but when you boil it down to what you're doing, you essentially just have a couple guns that shoot magic instead of bullets, and the gun is your hand. But it's a really, really cool world. It looks beautiful, like as you said. I think it's really great at the immersion of it, and I agree with you. I don't think this is the best time for this game, which is a bit of a bummer coming off the back of Horizon and Elden Ring, and you know, just the open world glut that we've kind of had. But there's a lot I think that's really cool about it in those opening hours, and so I'm excited to see it through,
and we'll be able to talk about it more next week. We are still pretty embargoed on what we can discuss, so it's very just top down, but next week's episode we can go into it a little bit more.
Yeah, absolutely, since it's out I think next Friday the 25th. But until then, that's gonna pretty much wrap us up for this week's show. Seth, thank you for joining us for this episode.
Thank you for having me.
Of course. And as we said, you can go check out Nintendo Voice Chat with Seth if you want to hear more of his beautiful voice on Thursdays. Correct.
It's Thursdays at 3:00 Pacific time, 6-ish,
somewhere in that window that we also post. Yeah,
Thursday afternoon.
Exactly. And at least last week and this week, you can also catch Seth and I together on Next Gen Console Watch as well, which airs on Fridays. Before we wrap up, though, any other stuff to plug, Mark?
No, I've been playing a lot of Grand Theft Auto 5. I think it runs insanely good on PS5 and Series X. I've been playing it on both because of work. So we have some GTA stuff up now, but for the most part, the game's $10 on PlayStation. So yeah, if you're even a little bit curious, you'll probably just get it. And GTA Online is free right now on PlayStation. So make sure to redeem
it. You have PS Plus. Otherwise,
if you have PS Plus.
Which hopefully you do at this point. But
because you should be using it to redeem your Apple Plus thing so you can watch Severance.
Exactly. Seth, anything else besides MVC that you want to plug before we wrap up?
My Steam Deck review just went live, so go and check that out. Like, literally, it just went live. Final review. I scored it. I'm not going to tell you what I scored it, though.
Ooh, a cliffhanger. Out. Well, look forward to that if you want the only way to be able to play God of War handheld.
It is God of War on Steam Deck, and I say this in the review. It's unbelievable. Like, the whole time I'm playing, I'm like, I can't believe this is a real thing that I'm doing. So
it's great to have. Back. And Jada, as we wrap up, anything that you want to plug? Jada is still finishing her mic and everything. So I'm just going to say, as I mentioned last week, don't forget to check out our history of the state of play.
Can you guys hear me? Give me a thumbs up if you can hear me. Cool. Yep. Yes. So sorry about that. Internet died. So, you know, hey, snafus. Gotta love it. Yeah. So plugging things. We did a really cool new discussion format on IGN.com last week, where it was tell us about your favorite Elden Ring death or funniest Elden Ring death. A lot of great stories from the community in there. A couple of our staff members went in and shared some of theirs as well. So it's still up. Go and, you know, just search for it on IGN. And share with us your favorite stories or read some of the other people's. We'll be doing more stuff like that in the future. So really excited to connect more with our community for things like that.
Awesome. Yeah, definitely go check that out if you haven't seen it already. And yeah, as I was saying, the State of Play history, if you want to see a look back at when all the big PlayStation showcases happen, what they've shown, and hopefully maybe give you some thoughts about what could happen in the future based on that pattern, because patterns are real. Trust all of the patterns. Anyway. That's going to pretty much wrap us up. Thank you, everyone, for joining us. You can find us all on Twitter. I'm at JM Dornbush. Mark is at Mark_Medina. Jada is at Jada_Rena. And Seth is at Seth Macy. Thank you all again for joining me for this week's episode. And thank you to Red Behind the Scenes for making the show happen and dealing with all of our tech problems that we threw his way this week. Thank you, Red, as always. And thank you to everyone out there for listening and watching. We hope you're doing well. We hope you're staying safe. And as always, beyond.
Beyond.
Beyond. Beyond.